Prince Albert, husband, consort, and king in all but name.
I think we're only beginning to uncover Albert's contribution to British society.
He swept the young Victoria off her feet and shared his life with the Queen for 21 years. A life of passion and ferocious rows.
I will sacrifice my own happiness in silence, but not the welfare of my children.
She must have been incredibly difficult to live with.
You will not walk away from your queen!
Throughout it all, he was driven by fierce ambition.
He wants to take authority from Victoria. He wants to be seen as a leading figure in his own right.
With a thirst for control.
I am just the husband, not the master of the house. He was blunt. He was in your face. He said what he thought.
And a hunger for change.
How is it that England has palaces and slums side by side?
Eventually, Albert would take over.
They are mostly your affairs that occupies my time.
People certainly did call Albert the uncrowned king.
But he would pay a terrible price.
Like the hawk, I must not sleep. Be forever on the watch.
Drawing on private letters and historical accounts by those close to him, this is the story of how Albert rose from obscurity to leave his mark on Britain forever.
I'd say we're still living Albert's legacy today.
Without you.
When Prince Albert died at the age of 42, Britain was the most powerful nation in the world, and he was its most influential figure.
By the time of his death, it's clear that Albert was the driving force behind the monarchy, and that most of Victoria's actions as monarch were in some way influenced by him.
Victoria was broken. She'd come to depend on Albert for everything. And she would mourn his passing until the end of her very long life, nearly 40 years later.
Albert's wishes, his plans, his views are to be my law, and no human power will make me swerve from what he decided and wished. I live on with him and for him.
But who was this German prince who snared Britain's queen to become the most powerful man in the land?
Often we're looking at the woman behind the man. So it's almost like a reversal, a revision of history when we look at the Victorian age to look at the Albert age.
Albert's journey to the top began more than two decades earlier. In October 1839, he and his elder brother Ernest were summoned to Windsor Castle by their cousin, 20-year-old Queen Victoria.
He's very nervous about leaving Germany to go to a girl who he feels that he has very little in common with at that point, and he knows that he is expected to secure a match with her.
Albert was 3 months younger than Victoria, and they'd met once before, when she was a teenage princess. But now she was queen. The British establishment wanted her to find a husband.
People start to worry about the moral safety of the queen, and they are aching for a royal marriage.
Those around her felt that a husband might calm her down, that she needed grounding, in a sense.
Albert was one of several potential suitors.
Your Majesty, so wonderful to see you again.
The visit to England would be make or break for the young prince.
He was seasick and somewhat dishevelled when he arrived at the court. Nonetheless, he made a very profound impression upon her.
She was completely bowled over by his handsomeness. He had grown to be tall and broad and very attractive. And her diaries from those days shed light on an amazing attraction that she felt for the prince.
Bearing and style, something of a romantic hero as a young man, and she was a very romantic young woman, easily swept off her feet by a handsome young figure.
You sent for me, Your Majesty.
Cousin Albert. Lazen, would you mind? You must know why I asked for you.
I have brought one of my own compositions. Shall I play
it for you? No, you don't understand. Beloved Albert. I would be so happy if you would consent to my wishes. To marry me.
Oh, marry. Ich würde. I would be very happy.
Just 5 days after he'd arrived at Windsor, Albert was engaged to Victoria.
He finds himself responding very affectionately, very warmly. And I think even he is surprised by how quickly he feels comfortable to share these quite out of character outpourings of emotion with her.
The couple soon set a date for their wedding. But already, storm clouds were gathering. Albert craved a meaningful role. But Victoria would crush his ambitions and keep him firmly under her thumb.
The English are worried about any foreigner interfering in the government of this country.
But as your husband, I will be
Albert,
expected to...
The decision has been made.
Shortly after accepting Victoria's marriage proposal, Albert began exploring the country that he'd soon call home. On the 14th of November, 1839, he took his first journey on the newly opened Great Western Railway from Slough to London Paddington.
He was coming to a society that was bigger, larger in every sense than the society in which he lived in.
It was also far more advanced. The Great Western Railway was just one of many new lines connecting towns, cities, and ports. They were powering an industrial revolution that would make Britain one of the world's richest countries, and London its richest city.
London is a great commercial centre, it's a great port city, it's quite unlike any city he would have experienced before, and it's a kind of foretaste of the things that Albert becomes interested in.
But for the moment, Albert's mind was on his impending marriage.
I write to you on one of the happiest days of my life to give you the most welcome news possible. Victoria is so good and kind. I am at a loss to think that such affection should be shown to me. At the moment, I am too bewildered to say any more, save that my heart is swollen with bliss.
But Albert's happiness was short-lived. When news broke of the royal engagement, he found himself under fierce attack.
Some members of the press, the public, and genteel society were confused. How can this be? Of all the eligible princes in Europe, or perhaps even elsewhere, why him?
He was from a very small, quite poor German dukedom, which meant that he was very much seen as this kind of pauper German princeling that the British nation was going to have to pay for.
There was a famous rhyme about how he was coming to marry, for better or for worse, England's fat queen and England's fatter purse.
There was also a frosty welcome in Parliament. When Prime Minister Lord Melbourne proposed giving Albert a salary of £50,000 a year, there was a rebellion headed by opposition leader Sir Robert Peel.
I think I speak for both sides of the House and suggest a reduced sum should be offered. Shall we say £30,000? After all, it is just to cover the expenses of his household, which by its nature will be very small.
Oh, I fear Her Majesty will not be best pleased.
There was talk also of giving him a peerage, a dukedom, but that got nowhere either. Albert was distressed, dispirited by the negotiations, the argy-bargy, not only behind the scenes, but in Parliament and in the press, over the role he would play, the status he would hold.
The sky has darkened more and more. The Tories have cut my income by half and made my position not a very pleasant one. Already, there are storms in store. I believe my future lot is plentifully strewn with thorns.
He starts to feel dejected and he already feels that he's failing.
He must have thought, what on earth am I getting myself into here?
Despite Albert's growing concerns, the wedding went ahead. On the 10th of February, 1840, he and Victoria married at St. James's Palace. Victoria's choice of outfit set a fashion for brides that continues to this day.
Queen Victoria was the first monarch to wear white for her wedding.
There was not really a colour for weddings at this point, but she chooses a white dress made with lace from England, and it's beautiful, long-sleeved, simple. She has a brooch that Albert gave her that's close to her heart, and she puts orange blossoms in her hair, which is a symbol for fertility.
Thank you, Lazen. You may leave us.
I will just be next door, Your Majesty. Your Highness.
Now are we alone? My Liebling.
Dearest Albert.
Victoria, in her journals, expresses her delight in the physical intimacy and the physical relationship that she has with Albert.
We think of Victorians, of course, as being incredibly prim and proper, but Victoria herself was anything but. She made absolutely no secret of having enjoyed the pleasures of the marriage bed.
Good morning, sweet husband.
I am the luckiest man in England. I am most looking forward to our honeymoon. Where shall we hide ourselves away?
Something happens almost every day. I can't possibly leave London. 2 or 3 days will be long enough.
I think we'll have breakfast in here today.
Victoria was very keen to emphasise the fact that she was the monarch and he was the husband.
Victoria was not an easy person to whom to be married. She alternated wildly between wanting total submission to him and wanting her independence, between saying he was an angel sent to earth and accusing him of heaven knows what.
Albert was desperate to play a significant role in royal life, but this led to early tensions in their marriage. Victoria had been on the throne for less than 2 years and was unwilling to share her power. Her close advisor, Prime Minister Melbourne, agreed. He had huge influence over the young queen and didn't want it diluted by her new husband.
She was enormously close to Lord Melbourne, not only politically, but also personally. In a sense, he was the kind of father figure.
He became the indispensable helper who was always there to outstretch his hand when she felt giddy or when she was unable to move forward.
At this time, the monarch still wielded considerable power and authority over the government. All state business had to have the Queen's approval.
I think Melbourne is a very, very controlling character. What he's doing is shaping her so she becomes very reliant on him. He's the only man who's got her ear. Albert coming in, Melbourne immediately starts to react to this by trying to limit Albert's influence and power. And if he can make the Queen think the same way as him, then Albert won't undermine anything he says.
Albert came up against Melbourne straight away. He wanted to bring his own personal staff from Germany, but Victoria was told to block him. She was persuaded that Albert should take on Melbourne's own secretary, George Anson.
Ah, Albert, I'm not quite yet finished, my sweet.
Victoria, may I speak with you?
We are quite busy, my angel.
Your Majesty, I think I have everything I need. Why am I being forbidden from bringing my staff from Coburg?
Albert, your people...
I know nothing of this Mr. Anson, save that I have seen him dance the quadrille.
Mr. Anson will be an excellent private secretary for you. He is modest, steady, a very well-informed young man.
Victoria, at the beginning, is a very unsympathetic character to her husband. She is eager to maintain the authority and the control.
But, Your Highness, if I may, we are entering into a situation where there have been very few precedents. The main object is to avoid any difference of opinion between Your Serene Highness and Her Majesty.
The English are worried about any foreigner interfering in the government of this country. Some of the newspapers have already expressed their hope that you wouldn't interfere.
As consort to the Queen, it will be prudent that you should not take part in any political matters.
But as your husband, I will be
Albert,
expected to...
The decision has been made.
Victoria's attitude to Albert in those early months was very mixed. On the one hand, she was raging that the English authorities wouldn't allow him, you know, a title, wouldn't allow him a sufficient income. On the other hand, she was actually at least complicit in that process. There really were moments when it was her denying him a title, denying him any kind of authority or really any role. It's a very strange mixture in her.
There were personal as well as professional tensions between the royal couple, a result of their wildly different personalities.
Albert was very sensitive to conflict, and really hated to argue with the people that he loved. Victoria, in contrast, was a highly passionate character, very driven by emotion and prone to outbursts and sometimes to temper tantrums.
And as Albert quickly discovered, there were three people in the marriage. Himself, Victoria, and her childhood governess, the formidable Baroness Louise Lazen.
Baroness Lazen was a problem for Albert from the start. She'd had this incredibly strong influence over Victoria.
She'd come from Germany. She educated and looked after the young Victoria. Lazen was strong-willed, difficult to deal with, constantly at Victoria's side, even after she became queen.
Following the marriage, Lazen continued with all her old duties, including running the royal palaces. She also kept strict control over the queen and made little attempt to hide her dislike of Albert.
Try it like this, meine Liebchen.
Your Majesty, the Prime Minister has arrived. This afternoon's post.
Thank you, Lazen.
Her Majesty alone must manage her sovereign duties.
Prince Albert felt irritated by Baroness Lazen's interventions right from day one. He felt that she frequently would find excuses to come in when they were having quiet moments together and would suddenly have some matter of state business that required Victoria urgently and for which Albert was not required.
Albert did have one ally in the royal household, his secretary, George Anson. Despite being appointed against Albert's wishes, the two men had struck up a solid friendship.
Your net, sir.
Oh, thank you, Anson.
Did she shut you out again?
The moment Melbourne arrives, she swoops in,
grabs Victoria in her talons and takes her off like some sort of dragon. Hmm. Or perhaps a parrot. Head cocked to one side so her sharp little ears might catch the slightest whisper.
She encourages Victoria to keep me away from any public affairs.
Her Majesty alone must manage her sovereign duties.
Spot on, sir.
All I am allowed to do is blot her signature on the government papers.
I feel the Queen may be more influenced by the Baroness than she realizes.
I agree. With Lazen around, I am just the husband, not the master of the house.
Mm. As time goes on, Albert actually starts to think that Victoria is scared of Lazen. On a number of occasions, he made a request which contradicted something that Lazen had said. And Victoria reacted with such a sort of furious and disproportionate level of upset and anxiety that he starts to see that perhaps this comes from fear.
Get that woman out of here.
But I...
You have nothing to say that I care to hear.
Albert's continuing feud with the Baroness would lead to a crisis point in their marriage. But the couple would soon face an even greater threat to their lives. From the moment they were married, the contrast between Albert and his queen was clear for all to see.
On the surface, no people could be too different than Albert and Victoria. He loved the country, sports, quiet, early nights, study. She was a party animal, basically. Loved town. He was far more interested in family than she was.
In the spring of 1840, Victoria's worst nightmare came true.
Oh, dear God, Albert, make it stop.
I'll call the doctor, Your Majesty.
We'll be fine, thank you, Lazen.
Pregnancy in 19th century British society was a very dangerous affair. There was no guarantee that the mother would actually give birth in a way in which she could save her life and the life of the child.
This is the thing I dreaded the most. I wanted more time, just the two of us. Now my wings will be clipped.
Then let me help you. At least until you feel stronger.
Albert was elated. Not only was he to become a father, he now saw an opportunity to assist Victoria with her royal duties.
He's not underhand in any way. He's not the sort of Machiavellian figure who's out for power for its own sake. He's restless to do great acts and big deeds.
I have come to be extremely pleased with Victoria during the past few months. She has given me a stream of interesting papers to read, and only twice had the sulks. Day by day, she puts more confidence in me.
Albert starts to have a much more prominent role in terms of dealing with state affairs or just helping Victoria read through the mass of dispatches that she's getting every day.
It was during this time that Albert was invited to perform his first official public duty. In June 1840, the World Anti-Slavery Convention was due to take place in London. The organisers were keen to have a royal patron.
One of the key great liberal causes of this age is anti-slavery, an end to forced labour.
Britain's own history of slavery was checkered. For 200 years, it stood at the heart of a transatlantic trade, where millions of kidnapped Africans were bought and sold. But in 1807, slavery was finally abolished in Britain. And in 1834, it was banned across the empire. Globally, it continued, with slaves being shipped to the USA and South America. Many British businesses still benefited, which meant the campaign against it remained controversial.
It was still slightly radical. Too radical, in fact, for Queen Victoria to be openly seen to be the face of the anti-slavery movement. Too radical, in fact, for her to openly write and state speeches in Parliament to endorse it. This is where Prince Albert steps in.
I want to say here that the trade in human beings is not bad, not terrible. What is the word? The German is more powerful. Scheußlich.
Atrocious?
That's it. Atrocious. So then, I start from the beginning. I deeply regret that the benevolent...
Albert accepted an invitation to make the opening speech for the anti-slavery conference. Anxious about his English, he sought Victoria's help.
Persevering exertions of England to abolish that atrocious traffic in human beings.
Much better. Chin up. Like this.
Have not as yet led to any satisfactory conclusion.
Well done, my angel.
He is knowledgeable about that subject, in some ways more knowledgeable than the Queen, and more interested, more excited than the Queen.
On the 1st of June, 1840, Albert delivered his anti-slavery message to a packed hall in London.
I deeply regret that the benevolent and persevering exertions of England to abolish that atrocious traffic in human beings have not led, as yet, to any satisfactory conclusion. This great country should not relax in its efforts until it has finally and forever put an end to the state of things so repugnant to the spirit of Christianity and the best feelings of our nature.
That first speech is really important to him because it's establishing himself to the British public and also to the politicians of the day as a serious man, not just as the Queen's husband, a man that can maybe start making a difference.
In the audience was Tory leader Sir Robert Peel, the man who had cut his salary.
I may have underestimated the young prince.
He'd appealed to the members of polite society, the politicians who were gathered there, who had thought of him before that moment as a clockwork prince. Suddenly they realised that this man could be useful. Useful in promoting their causes.
The reaction to Albert's speech was overwhelmingly positive. Days later, as he basked in his success, he and Victoria rode out through Hyde Park on their way to Kensington Palace.
Did you see the letter from Uncle Leopold?
Yes. A healthy baby girl.
Soon we will be having our own new arrival.
Called Edward Oxford, went out to assassinate Queen Victoria and Prince Albert. He claimed to be part of an organisation called Young England. That was in fact a figment of his imagination. He was a fantasist. Even though he was initially convicted of treason, his mental capacities or faculties were questioned.
For the very first time, the defence of temporary insanity is used and is accepted by the court.
The shooting was the first of 8 assassination attempts on the Queen. Later that afternoon, Albert insisted they ride out again and was met with wide praise.
There was very much an outpouring of public sympathy for them, particularly given she was pregnant at the time.
Her prince, her defender, was there to make sure that no harm came to the Queen.
This was considered to be admirable behaviour, physical bravery of a sort to, as it were, care for a Queen, and Albert's stock rose very high.
But Albert's growing popularity did nothing to ease his restlessness. Although he was now helping Victoria with her papers, she still denied him any meaningful professional role.
You could imagine a situation in which he sits back, he enjoys a pampered lifestyle, but that's not really his character. That's not what he's been educated for.
I am bored with chess every evening. I would like to invite some literary or scientific individuals to dine with us. But Victoria has no fancy to encourage such people. She would not like any conversation in which she could not take her fair share.
He became deeply frustrated with this idea of just being an ornament to the Queen. That was not the kind of man he was.
To relieve the boredom of palace life, Albert began riding out to explore London. He liked to visit art galleries and bookshops.
Let's go.
But one night, he and his secretary, George Anson, lost their way. What he saw would affect him for the rest of his life.
He stumbled into the slums of London. Slums like Seven Dials, where pickpockets and vagabonds daily gathered, where the children were left screaming on the streets, where rats ran down the alleyways.
Your eyes open, Anson.
He would have found scenes of extreme deprivation and destitution. The 1840s are often called the Hungry 40s, precisely because there was so much poverty around.
looking at? Eh?
Just going about my business.
Life expectancy at this time in Britain was a mere 40 years. And almost a fifth of all babies died before their first birthday. Poverty and overcrowding were rife, sanitation non-existent, and disease widespread. Children were forced to pay their way. Any that couldn't had to beg on the streets. Many starved to death.
It was a shock to his German sensibilities. A shock because this was not the Britain that he was expecting to find. Not the Britain that was the most powerful empire in the world. And to a certain extent, he felt confused. Why hasn't anybody prepared me for this? And why isn't anybody talking about it? Why does nobody in polite society mention the poor?
Albert later wrote to his brother.
How is it that England has palaces and slums side by side? My heart cannot fail to sympathize. The danger of poverty is the principal evil. Means must be found to make facilities for the poor.
Although Albert was determined to help the plight of the poor, he still had no authority to act. But later that year, he finally gained a hand in running the country. As the birth of their first child approached, Victoria prepared to enter what polite society called confinement.
Confinement is when a lady of this time period would be taken away from doing anything physical, any of her normal work.
Albert now persuaded Victoria to appoint him as her stand-in when dealing with government business.
From this point, Albert begins to attend cabinet meetings. He begins to be briefed on all sorts of matters of state.
Letters to and from ministers were delivered daily to the palace in a red dispatch box. And Albert was now given his own key.
Albert getting his own key for the dispatch boxes is quite a significant moment. He's able to look over the material that Victoria's received and actually play a much more direct and independent role in helping her. It means that he's part of the monarchy. He's no longer the outsider. He's no longer simply the consort. He's someone who's working with Victoria in a very active way.
You see him when he writes, the excitement that he's got this extra responsibility now and his eagerness to do well and to give it his all.
I always commit my views to paper and then communicate them to Lord Melbourne. He seldom answers, but I often have the satisfaction of seeing him act entirely in accordance with what I have said.
On the 21st of November, 1840, baby Vicky was born. A month later, the royal family spent their first Christmas together at Windsor Castle.
The most common myth about Prince Albert is that he introduced the Christmas tree to Britain, which actually was introduced by Queen Charlotte, who was the wife of George III.
But it was Albert that changed the way the British celebrated Christmas.
Christmas, for a very long time, was actually quite debauched, and it was about revelling and celebrating with friends and lovers and things like that, but not about the family. Now, when Albert comes into the royal family, he makes Christmas about this traditional family unit. He makes the tree this focal point, and it's decorated for a child, really.
The tradition of singing carols was already established by this time, but it wouldn't be until 1843 for the first Christmas card, and 1846 for the invention of the Christmas cracker. Unusual in a Victorian father, it was Albert who doted on the baby, lavishing far more attention on her than her mother.
Albert, you're wearing her out.
Pass the little frog to Miller and come and read to me.
Sir, I'll just go and see how the gift tables are coming along.
Thank you, Anson. We'll have them in here next to the tree.
Put me down, you rogue!
Ah, an excellent choice, my darling. There once lived in a sequestered part of the county of Devonshire one Mr. Godfrey Nickleby.
Images of the royal family stood around a tree would later help spread Albert's vision of Christmas all around the world.
It was on a simple level that all families could enjoy and have. It wasn't them standing there in great ceremonial robes looking regal and distant. It brought Christmas, their Christmas, into ordinary families' consciousness.
There was one great source of uneasiness in the midst.
For Albert, Christmas 1840 was the happiest time since he came to England. He was father to a healthy baby, husband to a loving wife, and enjoyed getting involved with state business. But the deep tensions between Albert and Victoria hadn't gone away. They would soon resurface, stretching their relationship to breaking point.
I will sacrifice my own happiness in silence, but not the welfare of my children.
You will not walk away from me, Albert! You will not walk away from your queen!
When Albert married Victoria, she resisted his demands for an official royal role. But when she became pregnant with their first child, she relented and let him take over some of her duties. He was now getting a name for himself.
Sir, may I introduce Sir Robert Peel, Leader of the Opposition.
Your Highness, I very much admired your speech on slavery last year.
Oh, you are most kind, Sir Robert.
Albert had impressed the Prime Minister and other senior Westminster figures, including those that originally doubted him.
It would give me great pleasure to appraise Your Royal Highness of any new legislation, or indeed any matters in which you wish for more information.
They found Albert easier to deal with than his often petulant wife.
Victoria was temperamental. She was unstable even. Those in the know began to see that he was a very good and a stabilizing influence on Victoria. And they began to actually welcome his calming influence and to feel perhaps that they'd get a more rational answer from him than they would from his wife.
But at home, his disagreements with Victoria were becoming more frequent. The main source of friction, as it had been from day one, was Victoria's former governess, Baroness Lazen, and the control she exerted over the royal household.
Every time he attempted to bring this up with Victoria, she would fly into a fit of rage. Where it came to Lazen, Victoria was particularly sensitive, and he knew that trying to throw his weight around or trying to be too pushy in this area was not the way to win Victoria over.
Albert suggested ways to make the palace run more smoothly, but Lazen obstructed and undermined him at every turn.
The royal household was not well managed. He saw waste, he saw inefficiency, and in general, he wanted to be master of his own household.
Victoria, are you not cold? Is no one going to light the fires tonight?
As you know, Your Highness, it is the Lord Steward who brings the fuel and the Lord Chamberlain who lights the fires. The Lord Chamberlain's staff must be delayed.
But why can't the task be completed by one person?
Darling, that is the way it has always been.
But the rooms are freezing. The nursery is worse.
Might I suggest a blanket?
Albert, why don't you play something for me? That should keep you warm.
While he was trying to do work with the royal household, Lazen would just turn around and say, no, you can't do this.
The Baroness felt that she needed to protect Victoria without realizing perhaps that no longer was necessary. In fact, that was no longer correct for her to take on that role.
The shot, sir.
Struggling to know how to deal with Lazen, Albert turned to his secretary, George Anson, and his old German friend and advisor, Baron Christian Stockmar.
Might I ask, did your fire get lit last night?
Far too late.
I was frozen to the bone. I can't bear her any longer. But anything I say about the Baroness, Victoria takes so much to heart.
I have the impression Her Majesty may have more fear than love for her old governess. I suspect you may be happier without her.
But how can we get rid of her?
With the relationship between Victoria, Albert and Lazen, it eventually gets to the stage where Albert can no longer work around her. He needs the authority to do things as he wants to do.
But Lazen was about to stick the knife in. By spring 1841, Victoria had recovered from giving birth. Although she allowed Albert to work alongside her, the Baroness wanted that to end.
Lord Melbourne is here, Your Majesty.
Thank you, Lazen. We shall be along shortly.
Now that Your Majesty is out of confinement, would it not be right and correct for you to see the Prime Minister alone?
Baroness, I do not think that would be necessary.
Lazen does have a point, my dear. Maybe things should go back to the way that they were. I would hate for my ministers to think I'm relying on you.
Allow me to take the dispatch box.
And I suppose I should have the key back.
For Albert, just as it was so symbolic to get the keys to these boxes in the first place, it's very symbolic to hand them back.
Albert was determined not to be sidelined. But to win back his position of influence over his wife, he needed help from the man she trusted the most. Lord Melbourne had been a father figure to Victoria since she became queen. But in August 1841, he was forced to resign as Prime Minister and had to give up his role as the Queen's advisor. Albert had grown close to him and now wanted a favour.
Lord Melbourne, I was very sorry to hear the news.
Well, nothing is permanent, Your Highness. Now that you have stepped down, might you encourage Victoria to once again turn to me for advice?
Well, I...
Lord Melbourne, I cannot believe it. You've been such a devoted friend all these years.
Oh, you are too kind, Your Majesty.
These events, while disagreeable, are unavoidable. But it is a great consolation to me that I leave you in safe hands. Your Majesty can do no better than to rely on His Royal Highness with complete confidence.
Thank you, Lord Melbourne.
What if I...
Put your trust in Albert. Let him help you.
Victoria had been so close to Lord Melbourne that she couldn't bear to say goodbye to him.
And he gives her that nudge, that okay, it's okay for you to give Albert more responsibility. It doesn't look bad for you. If anything, it's in the interest of the country and you have my support.
With Melbourne gone, Albert became Victoria's advisor on all government matters. And his growing friendship with Sir Robert Peel, who now became Prime Minister, made his position even stronger.
Peel, I think, rather admirably recognises that this is a young man who wants to play a public role and finds work for him.
Now Albert had the power he'd craved, he turned his attention back to the problems at home. In November 1841, Victoria gave birth to their second child, a son they named Bertie. But Albert's joy was marred by his continuing struggle with Lazen. He resented her being involved with his children and was determined to make his move. The opportunity came in January 1842, when their eldest child, Vicky, fell seriously ill.
Sir, you must come quick.
Princess Vicky had been unwell for some time, and she did not appear to be getting any better. And this is really the catalyst which was needed to galvanise Albert to finally stand up to the issue of late sin.
Get Victoria now.
Albert felt that Leighton hadn't been quick enough in calling the doctors and that the illness had become much more serious than it really needed to. And that, for Albert, was really kind of the last straw.
Victoria and Albert have the mother of all arguments.
Get that woman out of here. I don't want her anywhere near my children.
But
you have nothing to say that I care to hear.
You will not speak to Leighton like that. I won't stand for it.
She has poisoned the child with calomel and half-starved her. If she dies, it is you who will have it on your conscience.
How dare you speak to me like that?
She has shown utter incompetence and you refuse to see it. You defend her.
I defend her because she has been my companion long before you stepped foot on these shores, and yet all you do is criticize her.
I will sacrifice my own happiness in silence, but not the welfare of my children.
You will not walk away from me, Albert. You will not walk away from your queen!
We shall never be happy as long as that woman is running the house! She has to go. Oh!
Oh!
Victoria was almost hysterical in her upset. Albert retreated, and the two did not speak for the whole of the next day. Instead, letters were exchanged back and forth in which both of them pleaded their case, and at first neither were prepared to budge.
Albert, I'm sorry.
I did not mean to lose my temper. You fly into such a rage and accuse me of being envious and suspicious. I feel overwhelmed.
There is an irritability in me which makes me say such hateful things that I know hurt you. It makes me miserable.
Sometimes you are just too hasty and excitable for me to speak of my own worries. For the sake of our family, we must live only for one another.
Victoria alternated between this slavish dependence on Albert, that he was the most perfect being on earth, and writing him these really virulent notes, you know, accusations of ludicrous wrongs, depending on, you know, on how her own mood was going, and that must have been incredibly difficult to live with.
Later that year, Leighton was finally dismissed from the royal household. Albert couldn't conceal his glee.
Those who tried to keep me from being useful to the Queen have been completely foiled. They wanted to prevent her from giving me anything of importance to do by creating distrust. Victoria's good sense has seen that I have no other purpose in all I seek but a means to Her Majesty's good.
It's interesting, really, that Albert still won out, and without detriment to his relations with Victoria. Could very easily have caused a bitter rift.
But even with Leighton gone, their marriage was not all plain sailing.
Vicky, you look perfect, my love.
As the family continued to grow, there was another source of tension between the royal couple.
Do you have to spend so much of the day playing with the children?
How is it possible for you to be on friendly terms with them when you continually scold them?
By 1842, Albert had assumed full control of the royal palaces. He completely overhauled the way they were run, saving thousands of pounds in the process. But his ambitions went way beyond the royal household.
He suddenly was in a position to take on those roles, those functions, which had been restricted to him.
He took a hand in everything and anything that came his way as this constant, insatiable hunger to be useful, to be busy, to be doing things.
The Victorian age, as we know it, was firmly underway. There were huge advances in transport, science, industry, public works, and Albert supported the lot.
Albert, oddly enough, like Prince Philip after him, was particularly interested in science and technology, and he saw that as a way that he really could make a contribution.
He became interested in industrial change. He became interested in scientific revolution.
In March 1842, Albert became the first member of British royalty to have his photo taken. Months later, he took Victoria on her maiden train journey, a first for any British monarch.
Isn't this marvellous?
They travelled from Slough to Paddington on the Great Western Railway, built by the country's greatest Victorian engineer, Isambard Kingdom Brunel. Albert also showed his artistic side. At the invitation of Prime Minister Sir Robert Peel, he was commissioned to oversee the interior decoration of the newly rebuilt Houses of Parliament. Many more projects would follow.
If you think about the Victorian ethic of improvement, all those institutions from clean water to improved homes to recreational spaces to parks to allotments, all those features of modern life that we associate with our Victorian forebears, Albert was a supporter and a patron of all those things.
In November 1843, Peel took the Prince on a tour of Birmingham. Sir Robert was from a northern industrial family and shared many of Albert's passions.
His relationship with Robert Peel is this perfect bromance of two minds who have the same agenda. Both men are very, very, very hardworking and have a strong sense of duty.
As the birthplace of the steam engine, Birmingham sat at the heart of the Industrial Revolution. With its canal network and newly built railways, it was the world's largest manufacturing hub, exporting goods all over the globe. From the mass production of iron and brass, to weapons and steel pen nibs, to chocolate. It was known as the City of a Thousand Trades. Albert inspected factories, foundries, and the workshops of Birmingham's famous jewellery quarter, where he saw the brand new invention of electroplating.
So by using electricity, you can bind silver and gold to base metal.
They can also scale up the process.
Imagine coating cast iron machines with zinc to prevent rusting.
What an innovation.
Well done, sir.
He likes watching how things are done and how things are made, and being in a city of industry is right up his street because he loves seeing the cogs in the machine that is Britain.
Albert also saw the flip side of industrial progress.
The land is covered in coal dust. The people are covered in coal dust. It was a city that was crowded, people living on top of each other. They were the class that ensured Britain's industrial output. And without them, there would not have been an industrial age for Britain.
Why do you still have people living in squalor at the expense of this greatness?
The sight of the workers and their families brought back memories of his earlier encounter of the London slums. But it was his visit to Birmingham that convinced Albert of the need for change.
These people, they have the most toil yet least enjoyments of this world. They live in such terrible conditions. We must encourage those with wealth and education to help the poor.
A British politician is more likely to have seen that as, yeah, that's the nature of Britain. Whereas Albert is more likely to see, in fact, no, this can be changed. This is something that isn't right.
Albert becomes a champion for the working classes. He becomes very, very vocal in his what he sees as a need for an improvement upon their conditions.
But in the coming years, his time would also be taken up by his duties as husband and father. With a growing family, Albert was keen to have a family home. In 1845, using their own money, he and Victoria bought Osborne House on the Isle of Wight. Albert spent several years renovating the property and laying out the gardens to his own grand designs.
Both Albert and Victoria adored Osborne. It was almost like a sort of a little continental holiday for them without ever leaving the British Isles.
With four young children and a fifth on the way, by 1846, Victoria was exhausted, becoming less interested in her duties as monarch.
Victoria. Victoria.
Sorry, my angel. What were you saying?
I just need your signature, my sweet. It's another set of railway acts.
Albert, what would I do without you?
Victoria allows Albert to take a much more significant role. He starts drafting all of her correspondence and she is just required to copy it out.
Hello.
Bertie, my dear, I'm sure your father has work to do.
Come on, I'll race you to the fort.
I think Albert was made to be a father. He gave so much of himself to the children when he had time.
For Albert, Osborne House was more than a holiday home. It was a place for the royal children to be educated and entertained. Out in the grounds, he would later build a Swiss cottage, a miniature world they could play at being adults.
He teaches them to cook, he teaches them to garden. He thinks about how to allow them to be children and have fun, whilst also preparing them to be princes and princesses of the world.
Albert often encouraged his children to put on plays.
Vicky, you look perfect, my love. Now, you are playing the part of Athalie, the widow king of Judah, which is the most difficult part.
Sir, I have the letters you requested.
Yeah, thank you, Phipps. I will attend to that in a moment.
Don't do that, Bertie. Can't you see I'm trying to draw?
You will need this if you're to be the priest. Bertie, my love, you are a Roman soldier. Please, come and stand guard next to your sister. Good boy. Alice. Now, the high priest would not stand there picking their nose.
For heaven's sake, will you behave yourself? Go and do as Papa tells you.
Albert's devotion to his children would become another point of conflict with his wife.
We think of Albert as quite a sort of stern, Victorian father. But in fact, he was much warmer and more committed in many ways than she was.
I think at times Victoria may have been slightly jealous of Albert's relationship with the children.
We'll soon have this merry troop licked into shape. Look at Vicky. She excels at everything.
Darling, is there something wrong?
Do you have to spend so much of the day playing with the children?
But this is part of their education.
Albert, I just want to spend some time with my husband alone.
It is a pity you find no consolation in the company of your children. Then how are you meant to be on friendly terms with them when all you do is scold them?
The children got in the way of this intense, consuming passion she had for Albert. And as more and more children intervened, you know, it created a bigger and bigger distance from him.
Albert's growing workload was also eating into his time with Victoria. During the late 1840s, he toured the nation. He laid numerous foundation stones, inspected docks and factories, and witnessed new scientific innovations. In 1847, he was even elected Chancellor of Cambridge University. Albert also worked with many charities, putting into action his plans to improve workers' lives.
Poverty, malnutrition, poor housing. This is the peril of Britain's rapid and dramatic industrial advance. Along with improved housing, we need education for children, allotments to grow food, and benefit societies for the laboring classes. I shall not cease to promote these objects wherever and whenever I can.
Albert took on ventures and projects that when he initially was involved in them, were slightly, if we can say, left field, slightly radical, slightly dangerous, slightly difficult. And what he did was he mainstreamed them. He made them generally popular. It made it so that other members of polite society could support it.
On his tours across Britain, Albert had seen so many technological advances. From the first electric telegraph, to the penny farthing, to the launch of the world's most advanced ship, the SS Great Britain. Now, he wanted to bring British industry to a wider audience. In June 1849, Albert met with his friend Sir Robert Peel and ex-civil servant Henry Cole, two men who shared his passion for British industry and invention.
Your Highness, if it helps, I brought some illustrations from the Paris Fair.
Yes, this is the sort of thing. What do you have in mind, Mr. Carr?
Could we perhaps have an exhibition of British ingenuity? And not just machines from the factories and fields, but inventions and scientific breakthroughs.
I think we should embrace foreign machines. Its scope should be global. The first international exhibition.
It would show how countries working together can advance the human race.
But it does need to be a showcase of science and art.
Gentlemen, we will make this the greatest exhibition the world has ever seen.
Cole and Albert worked very well together. They shared a common vision of making a grand statement, of doing something on a grand scale.
On the 21st of March, 1850, Albert announced the plans for the so-called Great Exhibition at the Mansion House in London. It promised to be one of the most ambitious events ever staged. There was widespread enthusiasm, but also fierce opposition.
There were a litany of complaints. Why should we do this? Why should we spend public money on a great cultural project?
Surely this exhibition would become the source for anarchists, terrorists, with people not be coming there to assassinate noblemen and dignitaries. All this cost, for what benefit, what purpose?
Even the leaders of science and industry really didn't quite see the point at first.
Undeterred, Albert pressed ahead, immersing himself in every aspect of the vast project.
He's having a dead animal's hanging.
But in the midst of it all, there was a double tragedy. The death of his secretary, George Anson, and his close friend, Sir Robert Peel.
The opponents of the exhibition continue to work people into a panic. Some call it a great absurdity. There is a move to drive us out of Hyde Park. Now that death has snatched Peel from us, he was to lead our defense. We are on the verge of abandoning the exhibition altogether.
Depressed and demoralized, and with less than a year before his greatest project was due to open, Albert thought it might never see the light of day. Others feared the stress might even kill him. Following the announcement of his great exhibition, Albert was overwhelmed by a barrage of criticism. The original plan for a vast brick building had been rejected outright. But a late entry came from former gardener Joseph Paxton. He proposed a giant glasshouse, the Crystal Palace.
Paxton had experience of building large iron, timber and glass conservatories in his employment with the Duke of Devonshire at Chatsworth.
His design won praise in the press, and work began in July 1850 at the site in Hyde Park. It would cover 16 acres, require 4,500 tons of iron, and be encased in almost 300,000 panes of glass. It was the first large prefabricated building in the world, with parts built in Birmingham and brought to London by rail.
Ah, Your Majesty. Please be careful where you step.
Thank you, Phillips. My word. Mr. Paxton's Crystal Palace is certainly taking shape. I remember seeing his glass house at Chatsworth, but this is... Isn't it beautiful, Vicky?
It is going up at great speed, Your Majesty. His Royal Highness insists on being across every detail.
In such a hive of activity, you'll always find my husband centre stage.
My darling. Dearest Vicky. Now, you must be careful of the workmen. Come. Come see our plans.
You've made such progress.
Thank you, mein Liebling.
The angel, you look tired. Can others not take the burden for a while?
If only they could. What do they call it, Cole? The greatest trash? Greatest fraud?
Well, I hear that some mathematicians have calculated that the Crystal Palace will blow down in the first strong gale.
Some religious scholars call it the Second Tower of Babel, and that it will draw the vengeance of an offended god.
Oh, Your Highness, I can give no guarantees against such perils.
Mr. Cole.
Albert, my dear, you will prevail.
But none of the predictions of disaster proved to be founded. The building was completed in just 6 months, and then filled with over 100,000 exhibits from across the world. On the 1st of May, 1851, Albert and Cole's great exhibition was opened to universal acclaim. More than 6 million visitors came through the doors during the 5.5 months it was open.
Everybody that was everybody went to the great exhibition. They came because it was the thing to do. It was the place to be.
One of the great innovations was to introduce the workman's ticket, the cheap tickets, which allowed members of the working classes to come.
People came from across the country on the newly opened railways. An estimated 150,000 arrived in London on trains chartered by Britain's first travel agent, Mr. Thomas Cook.
People came away completely dazed. This was like opening an encyclopedia. You didn't know where to start.
You would have found machinery. You would have found raw materials. You would have found fine furniture.
You would see agricultural machinery in particular, steam engines of every kind.
During the summer of 1851, Victoria visited the exhibition 30 times. One of the most popular displays was the Kohinoor diamond, surrendered to the Queen in 1849 by the Maharaja of Lahore.
What do you think? It does not sparkle as much as I'd hoped. Maybe I will get it recut.
I think it is magnificent. Albert. Your Crystal Palace is a triumph. You have raised the monarchy to the highest pinnacle of respect.
Thank you.
Queen Victoria was utterly and completely relieved that dear Albert had brought off this astounding success.
She soaked up all this admiration and people just looking around in amazement at what had been achieved. And she felt it really was Albert's defining moment.
Even before it closed its doors in October that year, the exhibition had made a huge profit. Albert knew how he wanted to spend it.
The concept of using the profits of the exhibition to then provide a kind of permanent legacy is one that very much appeals to him. The building of museums for popular education.
While the Crystal Palace itself was later moved and rebuilt in Sydenham, South London, Albert and Cole planned to buy a plot of land just across from Hyde Park to build a new village of museums.
These new museums, as well as machines, we could also show antiquities and sculptures.
Yes. And these institutes should have libraries and rooms to share ideas. And they will be open to all people, not just the educated classes.
The site was nicknamed Albertopolis and would become the new suburb of South Kensington. Cole was later made director of the South Kensington Museum, subsequently renamed the V&A. Over the next four decades, the site would become home to the Royal Albert Hall, the Natural History Museum, the Royal College of Music, and the Imperial Institute, later known as Imperial College. And it was all down, in large part, to Albert.
Albert became known as a man who did everything. They recognised that what he was doing was for them. And you see this wonderful shift at this time where people start to become reliant on him and what he's doing for the nation.
Albert's new status led to extra roles and responsibilities, yet he still volunteered for more. In 1854, when Britain went to war against Russia in the Crimea, he couldn't resist getting involved.
Prince Albert began to talk to the generals about raising entire new regiments and sponsoring those regiments.
Albert helped raise money for the army's first permanent training camp, which was then built in Aldershot. He proposed setting up volunteer army reservists, which later became Britain's territorial army. He met with Florence Nightingale and helped her improve the army hospitals. And he even came up with the idea and design of the Victoria Cross.
Being Albert, he says that it should be awarded to all ranks, not just officers, but to non-commissioned officers and to ordinary soldiers as well.
Albert relished the extra work, but it came at an increasing cost to his health.
Albert was always succumbing to colds and chills and stomach upsets that gathered pace and intensity as he grew older and as he took on more and more responsibility.
Still only in his mid-30s, Albert now felt the weight of the nation lay on his shoulders. The mounting pressures were taking an emotional toll, and he sought an escape. The royal couple had been in love with the Scottish Highlands ever since their first holidays there in the early 1840s. When the Balmoral estate came up for sale, 50 miles west of Aberdeen, they bought it. The price, £32,000, equivalent to £4 million today.
He loved the sense, I think, of retreating into this world where no one could get at them as easily and where they were just private individuals on their own private property.
Come on, John. Is it only one you can carry?
The royal couple started spending every summer at their new retreat. Unable to just enjoy the mountain air, Albert totally rebuilt the castle and servants' quarters. He also worked closely with his Highland servant, John Brown, managing every part of the estate, much to Victoria's annoyance.
Hello, Brown. I see you're keeping my husband busy. When will you be finished?
Not too much longer, my darling. A few more logs should do it.
Would you hurry back, won't you? Back to the house.
Albert was beginning to feel oppressed by Victoria's constant emotional neediness. This knee-jerk compulsion of hers that she always had to be with Albert. She's so one-note, full-on. Me, love me, be with me. I need you, I need you. He wanted to pull back from that.
Victoria's resentment grew as Albert still found time for their children.
She didn't enjoy them in the same way I think Albert did. And it's quite heartbreaking when you can kind of see a rivalry she has with her eldest daughter, Vicky, because Vicky is the apple of her father's eye.
Excellent, Vicky. Now, why don't we swap French vocabulary for history? Yes, take a look at this. Now, there was a huge amount of controversy about the accession.
Why didn't you tell me you were back? I've been waiting an age.
I'm sorry, my dear. It was time for Vicky's lesson. And then today's dispatch box arrived. Why don't you have a read and we will continue in tomorrow's lesson?
As Vicky grew older, it became clear that she and Albert had a very strong bond. She was by far the favourite of all of his children and very much like him. Victoria felt increasingly squeezed out by this relationship.
You spend every spare moment of the day out with John or teaching Vicky. And now your head is in state business. There's never any time for us.
But I have so much to get through.
It cannot take so long. When did you last play for me? Or read to me?
They are always pressing matters that require my attention. Would you have me neglect them?
You are so wrapped up in your own affairs, you can't spare a moment to help keep my spirits up.
Dear child, they are mostly your affairs that occupies my time. If you will not do your duty, then I must.
Albert had developed a pathological obsession with work. Now effectively a full-time stand-in for the Queen, there were also countless meetings, charitable commitments, and the running of the royal household. There was little time left for Victoria. But time for Albert was fast running out. Albert's growing obsession with his work and public duties never let up. Rising at 5 every morning and working late into the night, by the dawn of the 1860s, he had become mentally and physically drained.
The profound set of responsibilities and interests that he has are beginning to take their toll on him.
He described himself in a letter to his eldest daughter, Vicky, as being like the treadmill donkey on the mill at Osborne.
Thank you, Phipps.
I hear that Mr. Cole wants to expand the South Kensington site.
It's a new museum of natural history. It's for Richard Owen to house his collection of fossils and animals and...
Dinosaurs?
That's it.
I'm sure Mr. Darwin might have some exhibits to add to the display, so long as he and Owen are back on speaking terms. Can I get you something, sir?
I'm all right. It'll pass.
I'll call a doctor.
I'm fine. Dare not stop.
Like the hawk, I must not sleep. And be forever on the watch.
One of the traits that he had developed from a young age was a complete inability to delegate. And by this stage, he's taken on more than he can really handle.
Albert was now dogged by poor health, often complaining of crippling stomach pains.
If you take a close look at Albert's letters, diaries, and the Queen's account of him over many years, you get a very, very clear sense of a pattern of ill health becoming more and more chronic. It fits Crohn's disease in many respects, but of course, Crohn's disease wasn't even identified.
Matters weren't helped by the behaviour of Albert and Victoria's eldest son. Bertie, the Prince of Wales, had been a difficult child. Now 20, he was in the army and causing trouble in the ranks.
Did you read the letter from his commanding officer?
His idleness and disregard for everything is enough to break one's heart.
He seems to take no interest in anything except clothes and the latest boot fashions. Despite my lessons, I fear his intellect pales in comparison to his sister.
Why doesn't he listen to you?
In November 1861, the royal couple received news from Bertie's training camp in Ireland. He'd been found in bed with an actress named Nellie Clifton.
The revelations completely devastated his father. Everything that he had hoped to stamp out of his children seemed to be manifesting itself in his son and heir.
If there was one thing he was utterly obsessed with, it was preserving the moral uprightness of the royal family. There should be no taint of scandal.
Bertie returned to Cambridge University to continue his studies. Albert travelled from London to meet him. Despite severe stomach pains, he insisted they went for a walk to keep their conversation private.
Your behaviour has caused me the deepest pain. What if the girl fell pregnant? You have willfully plunged into the lowest vice. I am still your loving father. But when I consider you will one day take the reins of an empire where the sun never sets, my mind becomes confused by the very idea. You must not, you dare not be lost. The consequences for this country will be too great.
Albert felt encouraged by their meeting. But the walk in the rain would have a dramatic impact on his failing health.
Albert had this great worry, this burden on him of his son's behaviour, and then this trip to Cambridge when he was so ill, further weakening him.
Returning to Windsor Castle, Albert was immediately confined to bed. Soon after, he developed a raging fever.
Poor Bertie got, in a sense, the blame. But that really is a bit unfair, because Albert had actually been ill, been complaining of ill health, and been noted as looking much older than his age.
Doctors assured Victoria that Albert would recover, but they were wrong. His condition worsened. Albert, the Prince Consort, died aged just 42. The official cause of death was typhoid fever. But doctors have since speculated it could have been renal failure, abdominal cancer, or complications from Crohn's disease.
When he died, there was this huge outpouring of public grief.
They didn't realise what they had until Albert was gone in terms of the roles that he fulfilled and how much support he'd given to Victoria.
Albert's wishes, his plans, his views are to be my law, and no human power will make me swerve from what he decided and wished. I live on with him and for him.
Victoria was utterly distraught, utterly at a loss.
I prayed we would die together. Why do I survive? How will I be able to go on? To live? To move? To help myself in difficult situations? Pleasure and joy, all is gone forever.
She wrote that my life as a happy one is ended, and that she had no idea what to do, even who she was, how to comport herself without Albert at her side.
He was the light in our home, the best father who ever lived, and a blessing to the country. There will be nobody ever again to call me Victoria.
Victoria would mourn her husband's death for the rest of her long life. While memorials were raised to his memory, Albert's actual legacy has quietly been forgotten.
By examining Albert in more detail, it enables us to have a greater understanding of his contribution to British society.
He modernised the British monarchy and taught Victoria that her job as monarch was to be an advisor to government, but that it was government that ruled.
Without him, the monarchy may not even exist. Certainly not as they do now.
As well as securing the future of the royal family, Albert was a man who wanted to make things better. A driving force for the early Victorian age.
He was an intellectual figure, a man of energy, a man of ambition.
Albert wanted British science and technology to be recognised throughout the world. He wanted people to be able to access it, to find out about the miraculous things that had gone on.
He had quite a determined idea of how he wanted British society to modernise, how he wanted the classes to come together, how he wanted ignorance to be abolished.
He was very honest and very passionate about what he believed in, and he really believed that his role was an opportunity to do good and to really make a change.
I console myself with the conclusion that from my heart I mean well towards all men, have never done them aught but good, and take my stand on truth and reason.
Xưa ơi, tiếng son ngày xưa. leave me? What would I do without you?
When Prince Albert died at the age of 42, Britain was the most powerful nation in the world, and he was its most influential figure.
By the time of his death, it's clear that Albert was the driving force behind the monarchy, and that most of Victoria's actions as monarch were in some way influenced by him.
Victoria was broken. She'd come to depend on Albert for everything. And she would mourn his passing until the end of her very long life, nearly 40 years later.
Albert's wishes, his plans, his views are to be my law, and no human power will make me swerve from what he decided and wished. I live on with him and for him.